So this is a great event to celebrate the latest terrific accomplishment of a truly incomparable scholar, our colleague Richard Epstein. My role is simply to say welcome and to introduce Sam, the who plays Charlie Rose for the evening, I think, and to say again how much we appreciate his being willing to play that role to help us explore a great book, Labor of Many Years, by Richard. And so without further ado, I'll turn it over to Sam.
Well, I'm going to say a few words standing, because otherwise
I'll kick him
Richard will not sit still, and this will not be possible. So look, this is a huge work, and it's a serious book. It's an important book in constitutional law. It shows Richard at his best. It is erudite, it is systematic, it is intimidating, it is a doorstop, it's got many many features all in one, and it's particularly welcome for someone like me. I have had the privilege on quite a number of occasions at this point to debate Richard, oftentimes on this subject, on the subject we're discussing here today, although to speak of a subject when debating Richard is to miss the point, because it can be anything. But I think it's a particular pleasure because, although we start from very different political vantage points, there actually is quite a bit of sympathy on my part for the central task of this book. And this has come out in a number of times when we have debated these issues. I think the most notably at Brown, I think it was 5 years ago or so,
yeah.
When we debated the New Deal constitutional legacy in front of a very large audience. And it turns out that Richard has been pushing, sometimes almost as a lone voice, but pushing for a number of years, an idea that a fundamental error was made in the New Deal period, in which a consensus emerged that economic regulation was, for all intents and purposes, constitutionally unreviewable, and that social regulation was subject to quite intensive scrutiny. And for people like myself, who I have been long uncomfortable with that consensus, we discovered that there were many common places of agreement. So for example, we are both quite sympathetic to the Lochner opinion. Richard to Justice Peckham, myself to Justice Harlan, but to the idea that Holmes's categorical rejection of constitutional scrutiny for majoritarian institutions having enacted economic regulation is disturbing. I am not as disturbed about that either, but no, I'm not. So we discovered common points there. We discovered subsequently common points in discomfort with the Erie line of cases, in certain quiescence on the part of federal courts in the economic domain. And so it's a pleasure to be able to see a systematic account of this from Richard, which is what this book represents. So let me say three quick things about the methodology he uses, and then give three quick examples, and then I'll turn it back to Richard. So what's the method? Right, that's one of the questions we're taught to ask about constitutional law works. What is constitutional law? Where do you get your points of reference? And Richard has a complicated answer to this. First and foremost, he wants to enshrine liberty. And this is not a libertarian book, as that is conventionally understood. Richard begins early on by saying, by referring to Nozickian strains of libertarianism. He says the following: the fatal weakness of modern hardline libertarians is that they cannot explain how states rightly gain the legitimacy and the resources needed to prevent violence, enforce contractual premises, and supply needed social infrastructure. So his move is to start from the premise of social of private ordering, and then to address what he considers to be the central problem in democratic societies, and that is excessive majoritarianism. Now, that's something I have a great deal of sympathy with from my work on weak democracies around the world, but Richard puts it quite pithily. So long as people tend to vote in their interests, the few are at the mercy of the many within any electoral process. And so the central organizing premise is that you must answer constitutional questions from the vantage point of liberty. Now, oddly, there is a strange resonance of another of our colleagues here, our late colleague Ronnie Dworkin. If you substitute liberty for equality, you get certain moves in Richard that look very much like the ones that Ronnie would have made when addressing many of the same constitutional questions. Now, where they come out is poles apart, but there is a striking overlap. Second, the method is based on the common law. And I think I don't insult Richard by saying that he is not at heart a constitutional lawyer. He is a common lawyer. And he is one trained in Roman law and thinks about the world through the evolution of cases and through the accretive processes by which law reaches rational conclusions. So he is not an originalist. He is not a living constitutionalist. He has certain tendencies toward an originalism of sort at times, but only because he thinks he can argue that the framers shared the same intuitions or some of the same intuitions that he had about the importance of structured liberty and the protection of liberty, but not because of a narrow textualism at all. In fact, the critical method in the book is something that Richard calls prescriptive constitutionalism. And prescriptive constitutionalism is a matter of settled expectations, of institutional quiescence, same as in the common law, where an intrusion upon property over time may become a prescriptive easement because of the settled expectations of all the people who have grown up with that as the world in which it lives. Now, the prescriptive constitution has a problem, which is it's the same problem that Burkean conservatism always has. How do we get from here to there? How do we get here? How did we have one set of institutions that yielded another? And what was the point at which illegitimacy became legitimacy? Richard doesn't quite answer this question. He thinks that politics has something to do with it and political acceptance, but that's not played out. It's not an Ackermanian type approach that tries to integrate into the central constitutional problematic a sense of political settlement. He has some notion of institutional settlement that looks like the common law. And the third most important part is that Richard is a consequentialist through and through. And so his metric for examining anything is, does it work? Has it yielded better results in terms of liberty, or has it not? And so you get one of the most fascinating parts of the book, a discussion of the 19th century distinction between commerce and manufacture, which is supposed to define the scope of congressional power under the Commerce Clause. Now, there hasn't been so much attention to the discussion, to the distinction between commerce and manufacture since the 19th century. And maybe that should tell us something, but Richard wants to revive that discussion, but not in terms of an original meaning, not in terms of a parsing of the words, but rather because he thinks that you can argue on functional terms that a competitive equilibrium is possible in agriculture, manufacture, mining, but not in transport. Transport is where it breaks down. And how does he know that? He argues that if you applied modern network theory in the service of the distinction between commerce and manufacture, you would get the right results. Now, for those who don't know, network theory is a problem in game theory, right? Game theory, once you go past a 2x2 matrix, two people, two decisions, the numbers grow exponentially so that nobody can coordinate, but somehow four people trying to get into a room figure out who should go first, even if we can't do the math. Network theory is an applied form of game theory. So judges are going to apply network theory in the guise of commerce versus manufacture. Maybe, but it raises the question of what can the judges do this? And let me give you a very current example. He has a discussion of the Noel Canning case, which is up in the Supreme Court now. It's a case about recess appointments. And he says that the recess appointments here should fail And here's the test that he uses. The historical practice has long been the opposite direction. So the question is whether that practice should be incorporated as part of the prescriptive constitution. The correct answer in this context is in the negative. The textual violation is clear. The new practice introduces institutional dangers. There's no reliance interest that protects the old practice so long as sitting appointments are not upended before the end of the current session. Now, if you piece this out, you have one part Harlan and legal process on institutional settlement, one part history, one part text, and one part a functional account of all the consequences, all in a nice four-part test. Wow. Judges are going to do this. And that's the problem, one of the problems in trying to devise a constitutional method out of this, is that Richard, and I think this is one of the failings of the book. Sorry, I had to say that at some point, otherwise I'd not be welcome.
We'll get equal time.
One of the failings is that he doesn't really have a discussion of the role of the judge. Now, Ronnie Dworkin posited the judge was Hercules, right? So he could get past this problem because the judge had all wisdom, all knowledge. Richard doesn't quite handle this question, but if you go through the tests that he wants judges to apply time after time, what you find is that the judge in his mind is a bigger, badder, and I think more juiced up version of us ordinary mortals. So if not Hercules, I think at least Hulk Hogan is the image that comes across. So quickly, a couple of examples of how this plays out. You know, there's a discussion of gay rights, there's a discussion of Brown, there's a discussion of affirmative action, all extremely interesting, all subtle, all nuanced in ways that really make you admire the attempt to come to grips with a lot of different problems. But the heart of this book is really the regulatory state. It's the New Deal consensus. And let me give you three examples of how Richard handles this that are not intuitive and that really get to the heart of applying common law methodology to constitutional questions. So these are boring, but they're kind of indicative. One is standing, of all things. Here's a big section on standing. Why standing? Because the common law recognizes the right to come to court as flowing from the nature of the injury. In the modern administrative state, courts put up a lot of barriers to individuals being able to access the courts precisely because they can't engage in the review of all the ways that the state might affect the liberty claims of an individual. So Richard is categorically hostile to modern standing law and wants to restore some sense of the common law, simpler notion of if an injury, then you have the access to the court. He says, anyone should be able to enjoin the operation of an unconstitutional statute, even if everyone else is in favor of it. That proposition follows from the anti-majoritarian theory of government and the integrity of structural limitations. This is very fine. It sounds like Aaron Barak. This is Barak's view of the standing doctrine in Israel. And I think that there is a sense of constraint that drives both. Another example. Central banking authority. Now we're getting into the kook wing of American politics and American constitutional history. William Jennings Bryan, cross of gold, inflationary pressures, all this sort of stuff. Richard starts by saying that he has a lot of sympathy for Ron Paul, right? If you read the Constitution, it doesn't seem that there is the authority for a central bank. And this has been the Jacksonian claim. This goes back a long ways in American history. But he says, if we follow this to its logical conclusion, we would have to have a gold standard. And you cannot have a modern economy with a gold standard, he says. And so he says, well, then he says, maybe you could. Maybe having the Fed has actually created the crashes of 1929 and 2008 through easy money. I'm not sure that works as a historical argument. But then what he ends up is saying, the constitutional transformation of the Necessary and Proper Clause has ushered in a revolution that no one can reverse today, even if one wanted to. The prescriptive constitution has taken over on these monetary matters. The original solution has been put to one side. Given its infirmities, no one should seek to revive it. Clear consequentialism, impressively done. And then finally, dormant commerce clause. This is a sticky one for conservatives, right? Because on the one hand, if you're a textualist, the one thing about dormant commerce clause is it ain't there, right? So you got a problem. On the other hand, if you're somebody like Michael Grevy, certain kinds of conservatives who worry about common law excesses, you need it in order to consolidate a national state. And so how do you parse this? How do you get between the textual void and the clear need for some kind of national coordination? And Richard says, under the prescriptive constitution, the dormant commerce clause should nonetheless be incorporated into modern constitutional law, given that the enormous boost it supplies to free trade is eminently consistent with classical liberal positions. Well, I actually don't disagree with that. I'm not quite sure how we got there. I'm not quite sure when the first case comes along how we establish its bona fides at the point, since it's going to be a predictive matter, what it will yield. But that's a constant problem in this kind of an approach. So I want to just give a sense of some of the problems, some of the methods. Let me just say a personal word about this. I met Richard 25 years, 35 days, 5 hours, and 28 minutes ago. Now, you laugh. Out of a certain age, we all remember where we were, certain things. JFK was shot, the Challenger exploded, the Twin Towers came down. I met Richard. Now, how do I know that? Well, I was in Dan Shaviro's office interviewing at the University of Chicago. Richard walks in and says, we should have a moment of silence. Ronald Reagan just left the White House, so I can date it pretty exactly. Let's just say that this was not the consensus view in the liberal circles in DC that I hung out in the time. But nonetheless, this was my first introduction to Richard.
I don't even remember.
This is not the book, what?
Go ahead.
This one you can't deny. I think this is not the book that Richard would have written 25 years ago. And I think that's part of the tribute to him as a colleague. I remember a memorable exchange with Ronnie Dworkin at the Dworkin-Nagel colloquium here a couple of years ago, where Richard said that one of the fundamental changes in his view over time has been an expansion of the domain of state conduct that he views as, that he thinks is necessary. This has been a recurring theme in his work as he grapples with his libertarian origins or his libertarian ideas that really ground much of his work and has become more subtle over time. In part, he attributes this to every institution he's been in. He spoke of debates with Mike Levine at USC many, many years ago on this score. And I think I'd like to think that part of the influence on the evolution of his views has been his role in this institution. I think that there is an attentiveness to institutional detail in the way we do public law here that begins, that insinuates itself into this book, and that is part of the question that Richard is constantly addressing, sometimes directly in taking on the work of Darrell Levinson or Rick Pildes, and sometimes by implication. I would like to think that we had that influence, but I can conclude by saying the other side of this, which I am quite sure of, that for us, it has been a great ride to have Richard on our faculty. The influence on us is unescapable. This is an important book by a formidable intellectual, and it's a great pleasure to be part of this, Richard.
Thank you. I don't know whether I should take your speech so I could go through it point by point. But I don't think I will do that, but I will try to see if I could remember. People asked me whether I had prepared for this speech or this day. And I said, I have no idea what I'm going to say until I hear what Sam's going to say, and he's not going to tip his hand. I said, that's the entire course of my entire life. People ask me how long it takes to write a speech, and I give the answer, at this point, 46 years of teaching and 45 seconds of reflection. and it's not as crazy as it sounds. You go very rapidly on particular cases if you are able, hopefully, to be able to keep the basic structure of your arguments in place. So let me see if I could remember at least some of the points that Sam said and see if I could comment on the way in which they fit into sort of a Le Grand scheme that I have developed. First of all, in terms of the personal side, I think the single most important feature of intellectual evolution, starting back with those debates at the billiards tables with Michael, was all the arguments that I've managed to lose over the years. That is, what happens is every time you lose something in an argument by your own lights, what your duty to do as a scholar is to figure out how it is that you could take the strongest points that were raised against you and incorporate them into your own worldview. If it turns out you can't do that, then what happens is you just have to simply truncate the kinds of cases and the sources of issues that you're going to talk about. And so instead of becoming wise, what you become is more narrow and to some extent more opinionated. So you have to be able to kind of sort of do that and to retool at a constant level. And in my case, the tooling or the retooling, to give it just a little bit of autobiography, is the question of how it was I emerged, not from a libertarian slumber, because I think that's wrong, but from somebody who was libertarian through and through to somebody who managed to think that there were systematic weaknesses associated with that position, which required in serious discourse a switch in the title from libertarian to classical liberal. And let me see if I can state that. In the early days when I started to do it, I was heavily influenced by English common lawyers. In England, they had a welfare state. The judges had nothing to do with it, so we tended to read 19th century libertarian opinions by great justices like Baron Bramwell and Lord Blackburn and so forth, and you started to internalize much of that particular culture. But the world in which these people were working was, for the most part, a simple world in which there were dyadic relations between two parties, landlord and tenant, mortgagor and mortgagee, buyer and seller, tortfeasor and tortvictim. And what you really discover is that the libertarian theory is at its strength to the extent that the number of parties involved is two. The moment you start moving to three, it gets a little bit more complicated, because now not only do you have conflicts of interest, but you have multiple causes of action, the possibility even of two-party coalitions, or something of the sort. And as the number keeps getting larger, the complications become greater. And that's at the point where somebody like Ronald Coase has to intervene, because in small party relationships, you tend to treat the transactions cost as a footnote. As the number of parties become larger in situations like acquiring property rights in a state of nature where the whole world is implicated or taxation and is very large, transactions costs become prohibitive. And so all of a sudden, you have to reorient yourself from the sort of notions of intuitive equities, most of which I think were pretty valid in the context in which they arose, into this question of how it is that you manage to get systematic Pareto improvements by each move, voluntary or collective. Now, what Sam said was partially correct about my position, but I don't think it was entirely complete. What he said is, I do begin with the presumption of liberty. And that is surely right. But the question then is, how do you override the presumption of liberty is at least as important as why it is that you start with it. You start with that particular presumption because if you give people liberty and you assume they have some degree of self-interest and some degree of scarcity in the world, allowing somebody to do what he wants allows one person to gain, and at least at this particular point, you don't know whether anybody else is lost. And so the way in which you start to override that particular function is to find cases where you can identify systematic losers, and that gets you very quickly to force and fraud. But it also turns out, as the ends get larger, you can override the presumption of liberty by developing a notion rather systematically, which I did in my takings book and before that in some stuff I wrote on nuisance, which Sam did not mention, known as implicit in-kind compensation. And so what happens is you take the just compensation clause and treat it systematically and seriously. What the clause starts to say is just compensation, when you have a comprehensive chain of changes, in effect requires that each of them be some kind of a Pareto improvement. So all of a sudden, just compensation starts to put you into a systematic welfarist change. When you then start to push it a little bit further and develop something which Sam did not refer to, the doctrine of unconstitutional conditions, what you're trying to do, in effect, is to minimize social losses in those circumstances where you know you're in the state of gain. That is where there's positive sum gains, but the question of how you distribute the surplus in the way in which it turns out not to destroy. And I wrote books on both of those particular problems. So what you're doing with the presumption of liberty is you're trying to figure out how it is that you can make these moves kind of cohere one to another. And it turns out that the moment you introduce this, the end problem, that is the very large number of cases, start to become tractable in a way in which they don't if you don't have these things. So you can start to explain why the first possession rule works, and then you realize you've got to have something to control common pool problems. Manipulating the rule won't do that, so you start talking about bag limits, quotations, and so forth. And then you test it against the just compensation limitation. My affection for the flat tax is in general because I think if you're trying to figure out how you organize forced exchanges, this is the one which has the least destabilization versus any other particular element, and that the growth effects will dominate the distributive effects. An empirical assertion to be sure, but one that I'm prepared to defend with a great deal of passion, but only on some other occasion. So you start to work through all of these things. And then the question is, when you get these generalizations, what Sam said is right. There is a kind of a Dworkinian willingness to sort of become very large and systematic. But there's a big difference, I think, between both Ronnie and myself. One of them is Ronnie did not study, as I have studied most of my life, mid-level courses, first order things, property, contracts, torts, labor law, health care, workman's compensation, whatever else it is that I happen to teach, my latest favorite being, don't you giggle, is water law, of course, which is, of course, one of the great subjects that you can teach in any law school, and everybody should be required to take it. But it really does teach you something about the way in which these sort of institutions are put together. It's also the case, if you start with the principle of liberty, and you start to take these forced exchanges very seriously, you also come up with a very powerful place for equality, because all the tests for disproportionate impact, equality with respect to form is a first approximation, equality with respect to equalization of rates of return is more accurate, the simpler rule gets you inferior results, the more complicated rule gets you better results, you got a constant trade-off as to whether or not the enforcement costs justify the efforts to get some kinds of social improvements, which is just very hard to do, and I think in many cases it does, but in some cases it surely does not. So what happens is liberty, as Simon Perez says, in the end, if you have forced exchanges, has to make place for equality. It is less clear how it is that a general presumption of equality manages to make places for liberty, which of course is one of the difficulties with all the standard Rawlsian formulations, which begin not with the notion of liberty in the form that I've said it, but notions of chain connectedness and other kinds of situations, which impose very powerful limitations. Now, that's the substantive side of this thing. And then the question is, what is the institutional side of this thing? And of course, what happens is when you put your institutions together, you have to take very seriously two problems. One, if they're too weak, you get institutional breakdown and chaos. Another, if they're too strong, you get some form of tyranny. And the issue is, how do you create systems of division that lead you to slow down but don't paralyze you? Now, the first thing to note is that most efforts to do this in most places fail. That is, if you look around the history of the world in an effort to try and create these things, the bad tyrant or something worse than that is a constant threat. And the American situation was extremely fortunate because notwithstanding one after another structural mistakes and constitutional development at the origin, you know, we do not have discretionary federal courts. The vice president was a mistake, or whatever it is that you want to talk about. We got enough of it right, and it lasted for a long enough time that we were able to put ourselves on a stable trajectory for which we all ought to be exceedingly grateful today. Now, how does one start to do this? I think when I talked about this book at a conference that we had on it a couple of weeks ago, Mike Grieber, whose name was already mentioned, made the point that he would not have begun with the distinctive American institution of the courts. He would have begun with the order that the Constitution was put, start with the legislature, then move to the executive, and then move to the judiciary as the enforcer for keeping the whole system together. And you know, that may well be right, but alia iacta, as the die is cast, and I can't run back to my publisher at this moment to change it. But let me explain what the judicial stuff on standing. Sam said, well, he has to treat it as a common law situation. And I forgive a public lawyer for his imprecision with respect to these terms. The common lawyer distinguishes between common law and courts of equity and essentially recognizes that they have very different kinds of scope and observation. The reason why this is important is if you actually read the text, and by the way, although I am not what you would call a traditional originalist, I am certainly a close reading of text, the judicial power shall extend to all cases in law and equity. Those words, law and equity, are not just added in there as a kind of an idle curiosity. There was a huge historical debate as to whether or not courts should have equitable remedies, as these were associated with the crown in the period before the Glorious Revolution, and there were many people who thought it was a symbol of tyranny. But then when you started to run a legal system without royalty, you realized, hey, how are you going to run a world without specific performance, without injunctions, without foreclosures, all the standard equitable remedies? One of those remedies is an action that a shareholder can have against a corporation. And the purpose of that is to essentially allow derivative actions to stop ultra-virus behavior. And the great case of Frothingham v. Mellon sort of looked at those things and said they don't work for reasons that could only be described as dim-witted and stupid. This is Sutherland. He said the reason it doesn't work is the coordination problem you have with cities and municipalities is very large. When you get to a bigger government, they somehow or other disappear, which of course is getting it exactly backwards. The problem of coordination for ultra-virus behavior is much more severe when you start getting to larger entities than to small ones. And yet what happens is the court defines its jurisdiction solely in terms of kind of traditional legal remedy, that is for those people who get hit disproportionately large by being run over a truck and not the people who might like to do business with them. So you start using the wrong analogies, you get the common law stuff wrong and the equitable stuff wrong, you get a very bad doctrine of standing, which makes it extremely difficult in many cases to figure out how you challenge unlawful behavior, including that of executive prerogatives to ignore the law, for example, with Obama-type waivers, some of the difficulties associated with NSA, which may be on the other side of the political spectrum. And it's just a technical mistake in terms of doctrine, and it's also an institutional mistake. So this then gets you to this question, this annoying question about the prescriptive constitution and how this thing works. And essentially, the reason why we don't have a strong account of prescription with respect to constitutional law is because we don't have a strong account of prescription with respect to the common law, adverse possession and easement. There's at least one theory which says that the longer you hold something, in effect, the more your right is, if you've held it validly. And somebody says, and if you got it wrong, it just compounds the error. So 1 year, you're doing $10 worth of damage, $220, $330, you get the 10, all of a sudden it's yours. And you have a very sharp line and a complete discontinuity. And there is, in fact, no way in which you can avoid that particular kind of complication. And since they're going to teach a class, it's not in protest. When you have that kind of discontinuity, it's extremely difficult to come up with a really sharp line, particularly since we cannot, in constitutional discourse, get anything that looks like a statute of limitations and are left with something that looks like the equitable doctrine of laches, which, of course, is notoriously weak to define and to enforce in any responsible way. So what you're doing in the constitutional stuff is you're mirroring all of the weaknesses that you see in the private law. And in fact, one of the things I always tell people, if you're trying to do public law based on private law, you cannot magically make disappear all the pressure points in the private law system simply because you go into the public law system. It's one of these transitions you just have to live with, for better, for worse, or for rich, or for poor. And then the question is, how long is long enough? Well, I don't know the answer, but 200 years for Marbury seems to work, and the same thing for Martin and Hus's lessee. But there's also a normative component. You know, you had Plessy around for 58 years. But the basic rule is it's not only time, but it's the question of the extent to which you move towards a classical liberal equilibrium, which gives you the substantive decider, which is why the Dormant Commerce Clause cases, which began out of a misreading of the Commerce Clause in Gibbons and Ogden by Justice Johnson and then carried over, is essentially the right kind of decision for exactly that kind of reason. So that's the whole thing. Then the question is, what about the peculiar role of the judges? Can they do all of this? And basically the answer is, I don't know, probably not, but that's actually wrong too. If you start looking, what happens is the success of judges heavily depends on the commitment they have to the body of law that they're working with. So you start looking at this Dormant Commerce Clause stuff, which comes out of whole cloth. And essentially, if you go through the basic rule of open competition, the non-discrimination rule, the exception for major police power weaknesses, it's a perfect classical liberal doctrine. In fact, The guy who got it best was a man who gets everything else, or many other things wrong, Justice Stevens. In one of his cases, he figured out that, in fact, you could not have an axle tax. You needed to have a Miles tax, because otherwise what you do is you get yourself an implicit subsidy of domestic commerce at the expense of foreign commerce. And he did it in game theoretical terms. So, I mean, you can do it, but you got to want to do it. And with the First Amendment, until we get the campaign financing, these guys understand the presumption in favor of liberty. Then they're very worried about the use of force. Then they're worried about the threat of force. Then they're worried about defamation. Then they're worried about all the stuff associated with fraud and the simple cases. And they're really troubled about privacy, precisely because private rights of action in privacy cases are very difficult to put together. And it fits extremely well. So not the question should not be, are judges capable of doing this in some abstract way? The question is, have they already done it? And the answer to that question is yes. And what happens is, if you look at the progressive part of the Constitution, they always lower the level of scrutiny, and then it becomes intellectual gelatin of the kind of gooey and unsystematic type. And the argument is, whatever you did in the cases where you keep intermediate or strict scrutiny is something you can do in the other cases, so that the issue of judicial role is, at least in part, an issue of judicial willingness to respect and to enforce the tradition. I can't change judges, obviously. But the point is, if you can show people how it could be done and why it ought to be done and point to the defects that we have in our current political order, Rick Pildes today gave a very long talk projecting the systematic decline of the general democratic state. What I've given is a prescription as to how it is that that might be cured. Thank you.
Let me ask you a couple.
What? I'll sit down.
Okay, let me ask you a couple of questions. So I'm supposed to take a little time, a few minutes as Charlie Rose before offering a toast. So I have a quote from your book that I'd like you to comment on, because it goes to judges, you, everything else. You're talking about the gay rights cases.
Yes.
And here's the quote. Mm-hmm. My own cowardly instincts are fully on display here. You knew I was going to pick that line, right?
Well, but it's true.
Yeah, I would have voted with the majority in Bowers and with the dissent in Lawrence. But 10 years later, I would keep the status quo, because even in that short time, I think that the outcome has been legitimated. But I would not make the constitutional leap on gay marriage in the face of divided public sentiment on a question that goes to the heart of the morals head of the police power. Can you unpack that? Because that's as live an issue. Now we're getting off the common law baselines
I'm happy to do this.
Public policy.
Okay, but first of all, let me just start with the normative basis of gay rights and then go to the constitutional basis and see the tension between them. As a normative matter, essentially any two people want to get together and form a union. Freedom of contract is the dominant rule, and that applies as much to marriage, at least as a libertarian would have it. And if you recall when I said about libertarian stuff, it worked best with small number situations. You can't get smaller than two. I'm willing to extend it to three, so I told my wife, if she's in favor of polygamy, I'm not going to oppose her on that particular issue. But somehow or other, it never worked out that way. So, I mean, you know, you start there and you get this. Now, the next argument that comes in is to say, but look, you know, this is a relationship that has always been sanctioned by the state. And I said, that's exactly right. But at this point, as a matter of theory, one of the central propositions of the doctrine of unconstitutional conditions is that whenever the state exerts its monopoly power, what it has to do is to explain why it is doing so in a certain place. And as I developed throughout the book, essentially the use of monopoly power is subject to the same kinds of police power limitations as the ordinary use of force. And in this particular case, if the only thing you can say is you're supporting some kind of diffuse moral sentiment of one kind or another, that carries no more weight in this particular context than it does in a flag burning or other type situation. So if you don't like it, basically my attitude is stuff it. And the answer here is, I'm not trying to praise or damn the relationship, but I'm trying to make sure that the definition of harm, as it comes out in the harm principle, is not put so much that it now covers offense at what other people do, because there's a moral hazard a mile wide. The more angry I get, the stronger my rights against other people. It is an outright invitation for trouble, which is one of the things why the dissent of Stevens in the Boy Scout case was so terrible. He said, people who have moderate views get no constitutional protection, only extremists get First Amendment rights. Why do you want to force people to the extreme? So normatively, I think the case becomes pretty strong. Now you got to put this against the Constitution. Now, I didn't draft this thing, and if you look at the Constitution, what you discover does not contain the words police power anywhere in it. But You would have a government so small unless you put something in there that you must develop, as we say, principled limitations on the use of liberty and property in order to preserve social order. And what they do is they add morals into this, and that's just completely discordant with the rest of this. You can imagine cases where you can't put a funeral home, which is going to embalm people, next to a spa because there may be leakage, but that's a pollution case. And you go through the 19th century cases on this, they're very big on morals legislation, and they're very weak on its foundation. So now you got the tension. If you start with the historical stuff, what you really are going to do is to find out that the morals head of the police power just swallows this thing and the libertarian instincts disappear, which is in fact one of the ways Jonathan Haidt wrote about this, that essentially all primitive cultures are violently anti-libertarian when it comes to matters of disgust, even if they are with respect to commercial arrangements on the other side of that line. So you got to face that stuff. So, you know, if I had to decide all the stuff about Corliss and Bauer, I would not go through whatever it was that the dissent did on this thing to make it all look as though it had been a continuous whole. I would have essentially voted with the majority and said it becomes a political question, much to my regret. But now when you flip this thing over and you're going to try to unravel all of this stuff, I do become something of a coward. I don't want to change decisions that I think have had relative degrees of stability and have a lot of moral, classical, liberal defensibility. So I'm not going to basically say, hey, let's stop all this stuff. But when it comes to the gay marriage issue, we haven't gone that far. There's a contested social reality. The consensus hasn't formed. The Supreme Court, I think, I couldn't write about it in the book because it just was sent to the press beforehand. But when the United States Supreme Court says, look, we're going to have the federal government follow the states on this, it kind of reverses everything that they've ever done on federal-state relationships since 1937. And then within a week, the Obama administration says, we don't care what the particular states do. We think a uniform federal policy is important, and they go beyond it. I get very upset by what I regard as judicial shenanigans, even though I tend to agree with the particular results. So, you know, my respect for stare decisis, tradition, and so forth, is that you find things that point in opposite directions. So a man who is commonly thought by many of his colleagues to be extraordinarily dogmatic on certain issues turns out to be somebody who is constantly balancing the scales. And it drives some people absolutely crazy. But I don't see any way not to do it. And if you look at serious constitutional opinions, all I've done is to order and put into more coherent fashion the full range of considerations that every judge, liberal and conservative, considers, but does not consider systematically. So that would be my answer.
So let me ask about one more contemporary issue where you take a very nuanced position, but I'm struggling to find the metric that guides us through. So affirmative action. You come out saying at the end of the day that the bizarre institutional balance that we have right now, which is okay but not too much, yes but not too apparent, is a defensible end state, at least for our time and for our period. Run that by me.
Yeah, look, I'm very much torn by all of this stuff, and let's start with the evolution of this. When I started teaching in 1968, this was a huge problem. And in effect, there was just a lot of muscularity going on. And I still remember the day when at USC in 1968, I was running the admissions committee, and there was a question of how we would run the quotas. And we had to deal with, at that time, Chicano students and the white students. We had to deal with both groups and figure out how they played one against another. And we started a 15-50 quota. The Asian students knock on the door, they walk in, and all of the students who were the black students and the Chicano students walked out in unison. They caucused in the hall. The faculty sat there twiddling its thumbs, and they came back and they said 15-15 is now 13-13-4. That was the way we did business on those days. And I have to tell you, it troubled me in terms of this sort of sense of judicial process. What became very clear to me is that any sort of abstract sort of colorblindness that I might have held at that time was intellectually, in the end, indefensible in some contexts and strictly required in others. So if you're trying to run an institution in which everybody but everybody seems to think that some degree of affirmative action is necessary for internal social stability, I don't believe that any external principle that comes from who knows where or to essentially govern the way in which you do it. So one of the constant themes in this book is when the government is actually running a business, as it is when it's running public schools, you may not like that they're doing it, I don't, but that's not here or here, is they have to get the benefit of the business judgment rule. And in this context, that means you take reference to what sound private institutions do and you allow the government to do exactly the same thing. So I'm not going to tell anybody they have to do it, but I'm not going to attack them if they do. But of course, the Equal Protection Clause never applied to any of this stuff historically. It was actually dealing with the equal protection under the criminal laws, and which all classifications would be suspect. One set of crime rules, you know, blacks get hanged for burglary, whites don't, women get hanged for burglary, men don't, whatever it is, you know, none of that stuff is tolerant. And so I become much more of a colorblind person and a sex-blind person when it comes to the administration of the criminal law, which is where this thing originally applied. And so what happens is, you know, Brown v. Board is, I think, a justified decision because of all the horrible decisions that had gone the other way. And you now see the irony. They put colorblindness in place at a time when affirmative action was not on the table. And now every single defender of Brown v. Board wants it to become a two-way test with different standards in the two different directions, which I agree with. So I think you have to be very candid as to what the limitations of the decision was, trace the history out in a clear fashion, and then come out fairly strongly on the side of the communities in Seattle and in Louisville, who sat down forever and a day, tried to figure out what the world they were going to do, came up with a compromise. And look, Nino Scalia would not be on my admissions committee, all right? I mean, you know, and we served on the same faculty for a long period of time because he has two strong views on these issues. And frankly, I don't think that anybody sitting on the Supreme Court should tell me how to run my institution. As a matter of fact, I can't figure out what the right property is in policy is at NYU Law School. Maybe you guys know it, but you know, it's obviously hard. At Chicago when I was interim dean, it was tinker, tinker, tinker all the way through. So your basic position is you don't solve, in a technical sense, an affirmative action issue. What you do is you basically break it down into short positions. You try to get the fix for the year. You see a problem, you fix it again. You treat it as a management issue. You don't treat it as a matter of high principle. Why is that? Because although some people think I don't know much about business management, and maybe they're right in the abstract, something which I've spent an enormous amount of time in my life trying to figure out how you do, running institutions of one kind or another. And the more you think about it, the clearer this particular issue starts to become. And the people, I mean, one of the great tragedies of having too many lawyers on the Supreme Court is most of them haven't run anything in their life. And so they don't understand how you kind of put complicated institutions together. On this issue, the big runner, and I hope she gets it right, is Elena Kagan. So she took a toy known as the Harvard Law School and ran it quite well for a number of years. But that, I think, is what the instinct is there. So the book is infuriating in some sense because I'm going first this way, then I'm going that way. But look, I'm willing to defend every one of those judgments in terms of the paradigms that I put out. This is not just a question of random decisions. It's a question of having a uniform set of questions to which you can give a reasonably coherent set of answers. And frankly, if I don't have a lot of friends on this, that, or the other side of the political system, doesn't bother me in the slightest. I'm used to being alone.
Well, on that, I think we should all join together. Can we distribute the champagne and let's have
a toast? No, let's have some questions.
Okay, while they're distributing the champagne, let's have questions.
Yeah, come on. Anybody? Nobody?
Yes,
come on back. And then Trevor.
Richard, I'm surprised to hear your position on the business judgment when the government enters into business.
Yeah.
Because you know, if the government wanted to establish a policy and crowd out private decision, it could simply insinuate itself into the business environment and then take decisions that you might find against constitutional principles if you didn't give them the advantage of this business judgment rule, as you put it. So what would you say about that?
Well, I mean, again, one has to be very clear. What you're talking about is management within the system. The question of anti-competitive effects is a rather different problem. The actual case involved with this was the issue as to whether or not those firms which are upset at the subsidies that were granted to TVA have standing in order to protect the particular issue or the challenge. And my view, of course, is it turns out that they do, although the common view is other. And this is, again, another one of these classic common law mistakes. The Judge Sutherland says, well, these are damn the map squandoria. They're simply competitive injuries, and so therefore nobody has any right to do it. But damn the map squandoria only applies to competitive firms that doesn't have the government situation. And so the real question that you have to ask is whether or not when the government starts to go in this thing in order to benefit its clients, whether or not it's taken from everybody else. And so in one portion of... What? Well, no, well, let me just put yes and no. So, you know, there are two constitutional provisions, one that's written and the other which I invented in 1987, but which in fact reflects the law, which is the one that's written is nor shall private property be taken for public use without just compensation. And the other one is nor shall public property be given to private use without just compensation, which is designed to deal with the giveaway kinds of questions. And so these are cases in which the so-called business judgment rule starts to result in net transfers out. All of a sudden you switch grounds and you now use the entire fairness rule because that's exactly the qualification for the business judgment rule that takes place. That was just not at stake in the Louisville or the Seattle thing. It was not as though they were giving sweetheart contracts to somebody who was going to run the affirmative action program and so forth. So I think if you put the two pieces of it together, it actually coheres pretty
well. What about
well.
Eldred?
Which one? Eldred?
Yeah.
Oh, Eldred is another case. Let me see, for the shorthand. Eldred is a case argued by Larry Lessig with disastrous...
Yeah, but leave that aside.
Okay, this is the question about the Copyright Term Extension Act. And what they did is they unilaterally decided to extend all of these particular copyrights by a very long period of time for no return consideration. And what happens is my view is that absolutely fits into the public givings doctrine, nor shall public property be given to private use without just compensation.
Whether held by the public, and
so what happens is the standard doctrine is the transfer out of something which the state owns. But anything which is in the public domain is subject to transfer if it's privatized. And this goes back to the long history of water law and other kinds of common resources. This thing is being privatized, and what are you getting in exchange? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. So you cannot do it. The reason it lost was that when this issue came up in 1810 before Chief Justice Marshall on circuit, he applied the infernal rational basis test to the question, in which there was actually a patent that had lapsed and then been renewed. Somebody had developed an invention in the interim period of time, and Marshall said if they reinstate the particular patent, then you can stop the subsequent use, even though it was valid when created. One of the all-time worst decisions in the history of patent law, because it doesn't respect all the retrospective positions, and it gets you exactly that same kind of abuse with respect to the patent power. So that's what I think about that.
Trevor.
Richard, one of the great things about this book and about your work generally is that, unlike, I'd be prepared to argue anyone in the academy, you're unafraid to touch every area in the law, including to teach it, but then to write about it, which means we can all find our pet issue in what you've said and ask you about it in particular, which is in a way kind of unfairness. Because
no, it's fair. I mean, you're at the disadvantage with all that specialization.
I call it knowledge. But
no, we know.
I agree it's fair because that's what I'm about to do. We'll have to talk later about the fact that I clerked for the author of Eldred the year that it was decided, and I have a bit of a different view of what it. But my question's not about it. So I'm interested in the separation of powers questions and the judicial role in that. And in particular, let's use the Noel Cannon case, the recent case. So a concern that one might have, but that I think you don't have, if I understand it correctly, is that there could be other reasons, apart from standing doctrine, to want to cabin, as a matter of justiciability, the judicial role in some of these areas. Mm-hmm. Because the courts are not well situated to know all the dimensions of the relationship between the two political branches. They can see one manifestation, let's say the recess appointment practice. They either can't see all the others, all the sort of side deals, behind closed doors deals, et cetera, that involve the sort of contestation between the executive and legislative branch, or if they can see it in principle, in the way an academic could talk about it or see it, they can't get their hands on it because of some limitation in their other, in how the judicial power has been understood. So, you know, it's hard to understand the recess appointment power without thinking about the filibuster. It's hard to understand either of those without thinking about the incentive to create White House czars over policy areas whenever there's just a kind of logjam with respect to putting into place someone actually had a department or agency that would run it. One response would be for the judiciary to say, we are by and large out of this if there is a stable practice that's had bipartisan buy-in, let's say, to address the problem.
The prescriptive constitution.
Right. But you don't do that on this, in part because you say there's no obvious reliance interest as long as you don't do it to, as long as you kind of just do it in a forward-looking way. But there might be a much broader kind of inter-institutional negotiation that precisely because the judiciary can only get its hands on one piece of, it should not put its hands on any piece of.
Well,
so what's the Epstein?
First of all, one has to look at the possible grounds on which this could be done. And let's begin with the simplest ground on which this case should be decided so as to avert all of the institutional challenges. The Senate was in pro forma session. In pro forma sessions, they had previously enacted laws like the extension of the employment stuff.
The particular case has
but the point is, let's just say, if you get that particular case decided, right, then in effect, Obama loses, and what we can do is put all the other stuff off to another day. That would be the first point.
So let's suppose it's no
canning two comes up, and the question is what goes on. Well, the question of how it is that the recess appointments and appointments in general go with the change in the Constitution is a profound one. I don't think you've actually gone far enough in trying to figure out the changes in circumstances. I did write a long paper somewhere about what happens is that the appointments power division between principal and inferior offices does not scale well with the expansion of the government. You can have the full dress hearing if you're trying to appoint 20 people with four cabinet positions. When you get 1,500 appointments, trying to get the full Senate to vote on all of them makes absolutely no sense. That has had a profound effect on doctrine because they deliberately misread the stuff to demote people who, by the standard test, would be regarded as principal guys and making them inferior guys because they're understanding and sympathetic with respect to the load. And my attitude is to turn a blind eye on that particular point because I think that the explanations that you give is relatively powerful. The second serious problem, of course, is with the creation of independent agencies with exactly the same situation. And here, you know, on the prescriptive constitution, I'm willing to go as far as this, which is to say the extent that we have a line that nobody can understand in practice between independent agencies and executive branch agencies, I don't want to create things. So when it came to the PCOAB test, and this is a point on which Rick Pildes actually misunderstood me, I thought there was no need to sever the second four-cause requirement given the first four-cause requirement, because I would have upheld it both ways. What's the difference between a 99% installation and a 99.9% installation? It's just not worth doing. And I don't want to mess around with this stuff because I don't know where I'm going to go back. And given the scale issue, it's not. But on the other hand, I am a fierce opponent right now of having any judicial power at specialized boards that are in the executive or the whatever branch it is, the legislative branch. They're called quasi-judicial because they're nowhere. Because that leads to a kind of administrative corruption and judicial breakdown, which is absolutely enormous, and you got to destroy it. I mean, I think NLRB, this is just indefensible. And that, of course, gets you to Noel Canning, right? I mean, in a kind of backhanded way. You run these things and you do this, it's absolutely the source of contestation because they last for 5 years. It's all heavily politicized. They're your guys, my guys, and so forth. So what am I going to do with respect to this? Well, my own answer about this is I would, in effect, enforce the limitations on as must happen with between terms. I think I would do it because I'm worried about something which I can observe. In all of these cases, when the administration has dangerous, difficult appointments, it puts them up at the 11th hour. So the Republicans have their nominees up in March. The Democrats get theirs in November, late, right? 2 weeks to decide, incomplete dossiers, forcing the issue. So to me, so long as I see a really systematic side of opportunism in this form, what I'm going to try to do is to force you back into more conventional kinds of characteristics. And I think that that on balance is probably the right result in this case. But as you say, look, I know if you can show me that I'm missing something, I would do it. But this is the difference between
but he
us.
Is saying, he is showing you that.
No, he's not.
Yeah. Well, yeah,
he
he's
is completely
saying you're
failed.
Not seeing, no. You're not seeing the full picture of institutional
arrangements. I understand what he said, but now let me tell you why he's wrong. He says there are other.
Bring us some champagne up here while we're.
He says that there are other issues. The real question is, can you identify them in ways that are counterweight? So I'm not willing to talk about general complexities. I'm willing to talk about specific objections. I gave one, you got to give one. Now, in other cases, like the war power and so forth, you know, to this day, we don't know whether the president can veto a war power resolution, right? It's not legislation and so forth, but we never had to fight it. And, you know, there the courts have stayed out. And, you know, frankly, I think that's probably right. They've even stayed out under the War Powers Act, which is supposed to be justiciable. I think on balance, they're probably right about that as well. So I don't mean to say that your concerns are wrong, but I can draw the circles and the lines in the war power in a way that I can't do it with respect to the recess appointments.
Okay, then let me offer a toast, all Richard, right. Since I was supposed to wrap this up.
Oh, I'm out. Now I can get...
And you get champagne. Okay. Look, everybody raise a glass. We hope to give you some sense of what Richard brings to this institution. This is only a small sample. It's great to have you,
Thank
Richard.
You. Thank you.